Hi, everybody. I'm Gwen Ifill. Welcome to the Washington Week Webcast Extra, where we pick up where we left off on the weekly broadcast. I'm joined around the table by Peter Baker of the New York Times, Carrie Budoff-Brown of Politico, Michael Crowley of Time Magazine, and Christy Parsons of Tribune Newspapers. Another small bombshell dropped here in Washington, for us at least, when Press Secretary Jay Carney, who we have all dealt with at the White House or in his previous incarnation as a reporter, announced his imminent departure.
In midlife, you don't often make a whole new set of friends, and not just friends, but people you would fight by and for under any circumstance, and that's certainly what I have been lucky enough to get over these past 5.5 years. So it's been a privilege, and it continues to be a privilege, and every day in here with you has been a privilege. People.
Every day?
More often than not, say to me, you have the hardest job, or you have one of the hardest jobs, and I'm not saying it's easy every day, but I love it.
Now that we don't need him anymore, let's talk a little trash. What kind of job did he do, Christy?
You know what? He did an Obama-like job. Mm-hmm. He came in and he's got a temperament a lot like Obama's. I think he's very measured. He's what he wants to say is written in his notebook, and he's going to say that and not go outside the boundaries. It was such a departure from Robert Gibbs, who was this kind of fiery personality who really knew the president, inserted himself into a lot of the decision making. And Carney was a little more like he was more like a representative of the president in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. But was that frustrating, Peter, as a White House reporter?
Well, of course. You think one of your own is going to go to the other side of the podium, he'll start telling you everything, and that's not his job, and he did his job well. He managed to shuck 2 decades worth of journalism pretty quickly to become a zealous advocate for a political figure. And
first for Joe Biden, it should be said, and Biden. Then into the White House.
Exactly. Proper. And he represented his clients vigorously. Didn't let up on his former colleagues who were sitting in the audience there.
What's your assessment of McCary? It's okay. It's safe to say now.
No, I mean, I agree with their assessments. I think that Jay was a frustration to reporters because of exactly what Peter said. And I think in some ways, Jay always tried to overcompensate for that perception that he may be, you know, too friendly to reporters. And he really was. He became very close with the president, and to the point where, you know, it sometimes was hard to get to him as a reporter. And he was very disciplined about the message. And the daily briefings, I think, became something that, you know, very routine. The questions asking about, you know, when we would ask him a question, it was through the notebook. He's a very disciplined guy, and I think that was frustrating to reporters. But, you know, he is a decent human being. You know, I found, like, dealing with him, he would send you an email. Sometimes they'd be curt, but, you know, he would lay out his objections, and he would be decent to deal with. And, like, as a reporter, you kind of want to have a human being, and he was that, and I give him credit for that.
You know what, this morning I went into the White House just to kind of check the temperature to see if I could tell, you know, is Shinseki going, is he staying, like, what's the story going to be today? And everyone was just so sad, and I thought, I didn't know these people really liked or even knew Eric Schmidt. But then as the minute I saw the president walk out to make this announcement, I realized, that was it. And sure enough, all of those folks had just come out of a meeting where Jay very tearfully told them that he was leaving. And he had, like, a really loyal, his staff felt like he backed them up.
He did. Okay. And I think what you said there is he'd love that job. You could tell how much he'd love that job. And it's interesting because it's not an easy transition to make from being a dispassionate reporter to being a zealous advocate. And I think he made it.
Was he, Michael, was he a policy guy, or was he just the message shaper? Or was he even shaping the message or just delivering the message?
I don't think he was deeply involved in policy, but I would defer to my colleagues here who probably have a better window into the day-to-day operation of the White House. But I don't think that he was a policy guy. And, you know, it's kind of an axiom of Washington that you don't want the White House press secretary to be too deep in the sausage-making because then he has plausible deniability at those times.
The most successful White House press secretary is always there.
Yeah, so, you know, he may have wanted to keep himself a step removed from the loop, but I, you know, welcome my colleagues to correct me if I'm wrong.
What do we think about his replacement, Josh Earnest?
I think that it's a sign of continuity at the White House. I think Josh Earnest is a lot like Jay Carney in terms of just, he's a very, He's a good manager. He's very good at delivering the talking points. He's accessible to the press. I mean, I feel like he's been more accessible to the press than Jay has been. And I think we may see a little bit of a loosening, or an advocate position.
I think Josh's challenge is that he doesn't have Robert Gibbs's longtime relationship with the president or Jay's stature that he has, and he's going to have to build it. On the other hand, Politico magazine, did something that was really telling. They surveyed reporters and asked them who was helpful in the White House, and Josh Earnest's name wasn't on the list. He's a deputy press secretary, and a lot of people wrote him in.
Yep.
Because reporters do find him accessible. So I think he starts off with
I'll tell you something else about Josh that I'm kind of optimistic about. He has been willing to get into the weeds with us as a press corps and negotiate access.
Yes.
When we've got a problem, when we object to... for instance, when the president goes to a certain section of Arlington Cemetery every year, sometimes the press corps isn't able to see it, sometimes they're held back, sometimes they go. When we spotted it on the schedule last week, I was the duty officer who was in charge of going to talk to Josh about it this week, and I said, hey, we're worried about this. And he said, we'll take care of it. As it turned out, he didn't go to Section 60, but Josh was willing to intervene to discuss, at least to go into the weeds and talk about the policy.
We have to talk about a few more things before we let you go for the night. One I want to start with you, Carrie. You wrote a story this week about the White House scandal playbook. And then, as it happens, the White House scandal playbook played out today.
Yeah.
What is it? And is it as much worried about Democrats as Republicans?
Well, the playbook has been that they don't fire people at the demand of Washington. They try to solve the problem, or they just wait. They express some level of confidence in the person under fire. They try to appoint somebody, do a review, try to deal with a problem, wait until the problem dies down, and then maybe deal with the individual who's under fire. I think this week was a very different scenario. I mean, you saw it start out that way, but the difference this time was Democrats, who, Tsunsaki lost support, and the president lost support too, and they made that clear. And so it was just a very sort of remarkable shift, and the playbook was different this week. It's the first time he's had to fire a cabinet secretary, and that's a departure from what he's ever done before.
Well, that's true. And then if you're Mary Landrieu or Kay Hagan or any other Democratic, endangered Democrat trying to run for office, you kind of want him to move on that.
Yes.
Christy, I want to talk to you about a story you wrote about this week about deportation protocol. It turns out that the administration has kind of shifted its worldview about whether to review the deportations of immigrants who are in line.
Yeah, that was kind of surprising, actually, because we were just writing last week that Jay Johnson, the Homeland Security Secretary, was getting very close to making a recommendation that would have reduced the flow of deportations. And the president had commissioned him to go and do this study, and it didn't seem like they were willing to back off of, accepting the recommendations at the beginning of the summer. They were doing this in response to criticism from advocates from immigration reform advocates who were calling the president the deporter and the deporter in chief, remember? And yet now advocates were asking them, please don't do it. Please don't enact, don't accept the recommendations, don't act on them, because you might derail the reform discussions taking place on the Hill. Mm. So they backed off. And it looks like they'll probably wait the whole window of the summer to let the House Republicans try to work something out and then revisit this in the fall.
Mm. I want to go to Michael now, because one of the interesting things that you wrote about this week was the problems which are still, and we alluded to it in the main broadcast, the problems which are still out there involving Syria and the difficulties in trying to move forward on that. The president spoke briefly about it this week.
I will work with Congress to ramp up support for those in the Syrian opposition who offer the best alternative to terrorists and brutal dictators. As frustrating as it is, there are no easy answers there, no military solution that can eliminate the terrible suffering anytime soon.
And part of the reason there are no easy answers is because we're not quite certain what the state is of the eradication of chemical weapons program in Syria.
That's right. Well, unfortunately, we're getting a little bit more certainty or clarity, and it's not good news. 92.5% of the chemical stockpile that the Assad regime declared has been removed from the country. So,
good news.
So the glass is 92.5% full by that accounting. However, when you're talking about chemical weapons, 7.5% is pretty nasty. You wouldn't want even 0.1% of that anywhere near you. So that is cause for alarm, and there is some thought that the regime is dragging its feet and slowing down the process, although that we are doing this in a combat zone, so it's hard to figure out how much of this is because there's fighting going on and it's hard to get the weapons out, and how much of it is the regime. But increasingly, it looks like the regime is dragging its feet. Also, that they may not have declared the entirety of their stockpiles, which is a big problem, that the whole thing from the outset was dishonest to some degree, that's not clear. In addition, this question of chlorine gas attacks that have been happening repeatedly. Now, chlorine gas is nowhere near as lethal as something like sarin gas. It is, however, covered by the chemical weapons, the International Chemical Weapons Convention, which Assad signed at the time we did this deal brokered by Russia back in September to avert U.S. airstrikes. So, Obama did not bomb Syria under these conditions of you'll declare everything, we'll get it out by June 30th, and you'll stop using chemical weapons. It kind of looks now like it's no, no, and no on all three counts. And I'm just fascinated to see how the White House deals with this. Yeah. There's going to have to be a reckoning, and I think we're going to have that red line conversation again.
And meanwhile, that civil war is still underway and hundreds of thousands of people dead. Next week, the president goes to Europe, Peter. What's he got on his agenda?
Well, more happiness and light. Yeah, he's going to be visiting Warsaw to reassure the Central and Eastern Europeans that the United States stands with them against any Russian aggression. There, he'll meet with Petro Poroshenko, the newly elected president of Ukraine for the first time.
The chocolate king.
The chocolate king, exactly, an oligarch who's taking over the country.
We need a chocolate king. I'm sorry. King.
From there, he's going to go to Brussels. He's going to meet with the G7. This is the G8 light. Now that we've suspended Russia, this is the rest of them meeting to talk about Russia, the guy they just suspended. It's a little like a club kicking you out and then talking about you behind your back. Then he goes to Paris, where he's going to have dinner with François Hollande, the French president, on the same night that François Hollande is having dinner with Vladimir Putin.
Huh?
It's not going to be the same dinner.
It's a lot of dinner.
It's a lot of dinners.
Lot of
and
dinner.
It's that seems to me a little like when you graduate college and your divorced parents come and you have to have separate dinner.
He's got metaphors for everything.
You know, that's good.
Not sports, at least. And then from there, President Obama goes to Normandy for the 70th anniversary. Putin will also be there. And the two of them will be in the same place at the same time. It will be interesting to see how...
So I know what you're going to be watching.
Well, body language. A little body language, yeah.
Well, it
used to be Kremlinology, now it's Putinology.
It's never very far. Thank you, everybody. We'll be here next week to report on whatever shoe drops next. And we'll see you next time on the Washington Week Webcast Extra.